way we treat children as regards forcing them into school and not inviting them into school means they're not being treated as people at all.
Children who've been home educated from the very beginning in particular they're children who accept each other and don't bully. They just love each other. And that's the word, I think, just love being with each other.
When there are gifted children in schools, they are made to do the same thing over and over again. So if they want to do something else, they can't. They have to do what the other kids are doing.
I think I'd be a lot happier doing the things I do now, other than doing it in school. Because if I'm learning about it myself, I can find out the actual bits of it I'm interested in. But I think in a school, I'd just have to learn the bits they wanted to teach us.
Most people think it's illegal to not send your child to school, you know, but once you explain to them that actually it's only illegal to take your child out of school if they've been to school. The whole enshrinement in law is that parents are responsible for the education of their children. So when you hand them over at the school gate, you're still responsible for the education that's going on in the classroom. So I think a lot of the time, parents aren't hands-on enough with what's going on in the schools that their children are going to.
People do believe that school is compulsory, and I believe that really most people, little people, should be given information and given a choice, because school is not always suitable for children.
You do come across people a great deal who have misconceptions about home-based education, that somehow the children will be losing out. The research, however, shows exactly the opposite, that it's the people at school who are losing out, because the ones who have been educated at home will be on average 2 years ahead of their school counterparts on the very tests that the school uses.
I found that my children would get up when they wanted, but that was normally quite early because they had so many things they wanted to do. And their whole day was looking things up, wanting to learn. It was just a constant learning the whole of the time.
Home-educated children generally are more self-confident. Now, you wouldn't expect that, because one of the criticisms of home education is that children will not be socialised. That's a standard one. And as a lot of home educating parents say, well, it's not a good socialisation to be spend 10 years with people you're almost the same age as you.
It's a common assumption that you are socialised by going to school, and I would say that the opposite is true. In fact, you're socialised by being out in a community and being sociable with a wide range of people from a wide range of areas, a wide range of cultures and backgrounds. And it's nothing to do with school, really. In fact, school damages children socially, I would say.
Every young person who's been home educated gets bored to death of being asked by people, but how on earth did you make friends? It's something you hear every time someone finds out you were home educated, actually. It's the first question people ask. It is far less of an issue than people think, I found. I've never had any problem in that area.
Another really, really important aspect, and you ask anyone who is in the science of the human mind and child development, they will tell you that play, creative play, role play, is absolutely fundamental to a child's development. It's so important. Children need to play, and that's back to the creativity thing, and the maths and English will follow. It does. It just does. And if it doesn't, then you're there to guide them through it and to introduce it in a way that means something to them.
What we do know is, if you're not prepared to be wrong, you'll never come up with anything original. If you're not prepared to be wrong. And by the time they get to be adults, most kids have lost that capacity. They have become frightened of being wrong. And we run our companies this, by the way. We stigmatize mistakes. And we're now running national education systems where mistakes are the worst thing you can make. And the result is that we are educating people out of their creative capacities. Picasso once said this. He said that all children are born artists. The problem is to remain an artist as we grow up.
I think the attitude that we're breeding in the way that the, you know, the system deals with education is that creativity isn't important, it's not necessary, grades are necessary, academic grades are necessary, academics is the most important. But my view is there is absolutely no point in having grades if you haven't got the brain to apply them to something. So there's no point in having sort of, you know, knowledge if you haven't got the skills to apply it. And that's where the creativity comes in.
Costs are an important factor in the decision to home educate. We do spend quite a lot of money on Julian's education. I think that would have been spent whether he went to school or not, because most of it goes on music lessons and activities that relate to his interests rather than education as such. So it's not costs, but what is important is the time.
You can home educate very cheaply, and in fact I know people who are home educating who are on income support and a single mother at that. The biggest expense is the fact that you are staying at home looking after the children.
I do have financial support as well, because I can't manage without, I'm on benefits, and I... Did I just say that? But I have the sort of support of Grace's aunties and uncle and cousins, and that's wonderful. And I think, you know, going back to the community, the essence of community is so important. You have to kind of be able to compromise and say, okay, well, for me, you know, I'm going to work out what's most important and then kind of work from there. And if you want to home educate your child, it's that kind of decision that is that important. And, you know, you might decide to do half a week each or something and maybe have less income, but still be able to support yourselves and home educate your child.
We had started off with my daughter in Cheltenham trying to go to school, and she couldn't cope. And in a very short while, she was running away from home, running away from school. And so I decided to home educate her. And in a very short while, I was told that not only would she be put into care, but my small baby, who I was breastfeeding at the time, would also be put into care. And in a very short while, the pressure became so great that we decided we could not any longer live in Cheltenham. So we moved off to a peninsula in Scotland, and we lived in a house that was, it was a croft with a tin roof, plastic in the windows, there was no glass in the windows, so every time the wind blew, it would rattle with the plastic, no water, the walls were all black from burning peat.
Now, it was the third system, the autonomous system, where the learners managed their own learning, that the Harrisons had adopted. But they needed somebody in court to defend the logistics of their system as being perfectly okay and educationally viable.
We actually ended up in the Crown Court in Worcester to get the judgment that is today what the government is fighting against, or Ed Balls is fighting against.
It was the judge in the 1981 hearing who came down firmly in his judgment that there's more than one learning system, and it was quite legitimate for the family to operate a different learning system, the autonomous one, to the one of the school. So it was the 1981 Crown Court judgment where the judge made that conclusion.
Thousands of children in England are taught at home rather than school. Exactly how many isn't known because they don't have to be registered, but that could be about to change.
A report out today is expected to recommend that all parents who educate their children at home should be registered and regularly inspected.
The local authorities rather rather were behind this. They got the government to commission a report into home-based education, and they fed into it certain ideas like, are the children hidden away in home-based education for abuse or forced marriages or all sorts of other things they listed, which there's no evidence whatsoever.
I've never heard of any abuse within home education, and I've been in that for half my life. I've never heard of any drugs or anything like that within home education ever. No, it's just the opposite.
And the government decided it would go along with the local authorities' request and commission a report into this. And they commissioned this person, Graham Badman, who was a local authority official, to look into it. Well, they could have chosen many people to look into it, but they chose a local authority one who was quite well known as his opposition to home-based education. And as a result of that, a report was produced which was very negative and very hostile to home-based education.
It's slapdash, it's sloppy, it's inaccurate, and all I can think of is that Badman had already decided what he was going to write before any of the consultations. So I've wasted hours and hours and hours on reading it, writing the report. I went to see him, I spent an hour talking to him, explaining autonomous learning. And he just, he quoted something that I'd said completely wrongly.
That's particularly sad when some of the recommendations do impinge directly on home-educated young people. There is a recommendation that there should be a power for local authorities to enter the home.
An Englishman's home, as they say, is his castle. Not even the police can do that. He wanted the children to be interviewed without the parents present. Parents have a right, with young children especially, to say whether they want their children interviewed or not.
I think it's a very short step from saying this is how you've got to educate your child to saying this is how you've got to feed your child, this is how you're going to bath your child, this is what time they've got to go to bed. So, do you know what I mean? People say, that can't possibly happen. You know, but when one of the recommendations in that report is that children should be allowed to be interviewed without their parents present, that's sort of starting to ring alarm bells.
We don't force it. We don't force a pattern on parents on how to educate their children. And I think anybody who's educating their child does not need to worry if we've got that kind of approach.
You know, you're just left reeling and think, well, why are they picking on us? Why, when they've got, you know, as I've said before, 46% of children leaving, school leavers not attaining this fabulous grade 5 GCSEs that they think is the golden thing to achieve, and bullying that is rife in schools and truancy that is rife in schools, and the number of children who are leaving school who do not have basic literacy and numeracy skills, which have been highlighted by people like the Tesco boss, Sir Terry Leahy, he's complained about, you know, the level of literacy. Why, when they've got all those things going on in school, are they picking on us?
I've believed that all my life, that, you know, the government doesn't want people to think, do they? Because if they think, then they're going to question their idiot policies, aren't they? And the way schools and learning is set up is that people don't think beyond what they're controlled to think, you know, like Pythagoras' theorem or whatever.
They want rules that are not permissible in our law system as it stands. But on top of that, I will fight to my dying day to protect children like my own, to be not to be harassed by authority. Ouch.
I think that yourself.